We are going to receive now another part of the meal. We're going to be inviting a young man. Youngish. Everything is relative. A young man to come. And this is a young man who has journeyed very far. He journeyed from England. The claim is the motherland. Well, England. He came to Jamaica. I wasn't absolutely sure what he was searching for, but the Lord found him here. But it's beyond that. When he came here, God arrested him and put in his heart a love for this country. And he began pouring out that love in how he has lived his life in Jamaica. But when he came here, he realized that it was a little too big for him. So he went all the way down under to Australia to get some help. And he found a wife, Elizabeth. And they realized that that was not enough still, so they had to get reinforcements. So they had two children, Zoe and Oliver. And this is a man who has epitomized living the gospel. And so if you want to hear from someone who I respect greatly, and I want to, I'm not bigging him up. All of what I'm saying is true, okay? So it's not embellishing. I really wanted us to just thank God for this man and trust that you will listen carefully out of the sharing of his testimony and the word of God, because he carries on him a grace that is lined up with this message of a lifestyle of evangelism. And as he comes now, let's welcome him. There's a saying that they have, that fools rush in where angels fear to tread. I have met him a few of those places. I don't know what that says about me, but David, welcome. And we listen carefully to what God has to say to us through you. Bless you, my brother.
Yeah, it's really a pleasure to be here. You know, I actually haven't worshipped here with you guys from middle of 2019. You know, from we got back from sabbatical, we've been worshipping with another small church. And but it's really nice to be back here again. A lot has changed, but a lot is still the same. And so, yeah, it's a real privilege to be here today. We're going to be looking, just as a quick thing, you know, the message or the title that we've been given, this thing of lifestyle evangelism. Now, it may be a little, that's definitely consistent with what I'm going to share, but it may be a little bit different from what you're expecting, because we often put evangelism in this little box, right? The Greek word evangelion means good news. So if you want to give the message another title, you could give it Good News Now, okay? The gospel is not about death insurance. You understand? The gospel is not about a set of different, you know, doctrinal points that once you tick the boxes, your thumbs up, and if you don't, your thumbs down. The gospel is about something that happened. It's a reality that happened that changed everything, okay? And so it's about living in the reality of what happened. That's a lifestyle of evangelism, and that's what we're going to be looking at this morning as we share. Now, you've been in the book of Daniel throughout the month, and Doggy spent a good little time in it, and then Floyd kind of developed a little bit more. So you've heard this verse several times from those guys. But I'm going to start with a verse. I better find the book of Daniel. Daniel 2:44. And it says, and this is just a quick context. I know you've looked at this as well from both guys who previously looked at this. There's this vision that Daniel's had, or this dream actually, so this dream that the king Nebuchadnezzar had. And he tells the people, you have to tell me the dream and the interpretation. And the dream is of this statue with kind of four different kind of aspects to it. You know, and then at the end of that, this stone comes out and destroys the statue. And it's Dana interprets it to say it's about four different kingdoms that will arise. And then in the time of that last one, a new kingdom will arise. Okay? And he says this at the very end. He says, in the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all those kingdoms and bring them to an end. But it itself will endure forever. Okay, so something is going to happen. This is prior to it happening. Something is going to happen, and God is going to set up a kingdom that will last forever. Okay? Jesus told us to seek something first, right? What was it? Right. Seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. So if that's the first thing we're supposed to seek more than anything else, is a really important question. So I'm going to put up three questions, actually, which I want to have in, you can even, if you want to write them down, you can write them down, but have in mind as we look at what we're looking at. First one, a really important question, right? What is it? If we're supposed to seek it more than anything else, what is it? Valid question? Okay, what is it? We also talk about the whole series is about engaging the culture, okay? And so you can use, I chose the word character instead of culture, but they're kind of interchangeable. Character personalizes it a little more, okay? What is the character of the kingdom? And here's a really key question. How can the people of the kingdom reflect that character, okay? So I want you to have those in the back of your mind as we look at what we're looking at today. And we're going to look, so just so you know, kind of rough outline, we're going to look at a few passages, kind of do a bit of a setup. Then we're going to look particularly at Daniel as a kingdom character. And then you're going to look at a few New Testament passages at the end. But to start with, I actually want to start with a little recent story, because it reflects this whole thing of the presence of the kingdom, this good news reality right now. And this is from a couple weeks ago. I don't remember the exact, you know, I'm getting, you rightly labeled me as not such a young man again, right? So how many weeks ago I can business again? I've seen so many weeks in my life now, I'm not keeping track. All the young people are sitting and sniggering at the back, right? So anyway, it happened recently. And we did always around back to school time in Trenchtown, we try and do something to assist the families. And so we kind of got in touch with a lot of the families that we're working with in Trenchtown over many, many years. And we said to them, okay, what would be a blessing this year, right now? You know, we've done book vouchers, we've done grocery vouchers, different things. And we kind of went to them and said, what would be the biggest blessing? And unanimously they said, right now is just food, you know? The kids are home a lot more, and we have to feed them. Can't send them to school to go get food right there, you know. And right now, that's the main thing. Just those food packages, they have been such a blessing to us. Please, can you bless us with food packages? So we said, okay, we'll do that. And then prayed about it, and it was amazing the way God provided. Just a quick, I tell you, this coronavirus season has just been amazing to see the provision of God. The very first back to school, I know I'm halfway through a sentence, but I have to say something, because I know a lot of you have a question in your minds, and that's if I have brownies for sale. Sadly, it's not that good news, okay? All right. But the reason we were selling brownies all those years, right, was to try raise a little change to keep this ministry going, because it was rough. You know, all those years we were just, you know, trying to do what we could in order to keep basically the wheels on the bus, keep the things going, keep the biscuits flowing for the kids club programs, all of that kind of thing. Because, you know, it was a really challenging time. And the first year we did a back to school fundraiser, we're like, yes, we really see the families are in need. We want to do something, we want to raise money for them. And we got the word out and we raised $21,000. And so we were able to do $1,000 to 21 families. And that was the full extent of it. And gradually it picked up, you know, people started to get behind this one a little bit more, and over and over and over. This year, with the food package outreach, we gave over in excess of $600,000 worth of food. Okay. In the middle of a pandemic, you know, I mean, God is good. It has been amazing just to see God's faithfulness. Anyway, so we did that, you know, and it was actually really cool because there's two sides in the community where they kind of don't like each other that much. There's some animosity. And throughout the history, you've kind of got to know that at different points. Plus, a lot of my team now, they're working different jobs. They're older now, you know, so finding a time when everybody could be there. When you're doing a food package outreach, especially if you buy everything in bulk, you have to pack out all the rice, pack out all the flour. I mean, it's very labor intensive. So what it does, it means that that money then increases significantly in value to the recipient, but it's a lot of work. And I'm there, I just don't have the team to manage this massive food package outreach. So I'm sitting there thinking, what am I supposed to do? How am I going to do it? And Liz and I prayed about it. Next morning I woke up and I just have this verse in my mind, bless those who curse you. And I'm like, bless those who curse you, bless those who curse you. How can I? And suddenly I thought, wait, I can get the guys from one community who don't like the other ones to help and go bless them. And then I can do another day and get the guys from the other side of the community to help and bless back the people that, so they're the ones that are always cursing them one another. Let's get them to bless them one another, right? And it was such a great, like when I went down to kind of talk to some of the moms who we've been, you know, caring for their kids over all these years, I said, hey, here's the idea. And first response was like, yeah, mom, we're ready. You know, and you kind of know that the Holy Spirit is already preparing people's hearts. And they came out and they worked and they put it and they were singing and we were playing worship music. And then they came and they gave out. And there was one moment in Rima where this lady, she was cussing so till because she wanted more for this and she wanted for this person. And she said, boy, when they give out, them always, you know, preferential treatment. And it's not true, you know, but I just saw some people stay, you know. But we had said to them, look, bless those who curse you, right? And one of the other ladies from up the road, and I, when she get vexed, she get vexed, you know, right? And so this person going on like this, and she know it's unfair. And I look at her, and we had prayed. We're just, you know, they're not even Christians, so I can't even pray that the Holy Spirit would fill them up, right? In order to be full of the joy. So I just pray that the Holy Spirit would superintend every interaction, overshadow every interaction, Lord. That's what we prayed. Okay, so she's there, this lady's going on like that, and you look on her, and she look at me, and she look at the lady, and she's like, the Lord bless you. Right? And I'm like, well done, well done. Right? Now, we finish give out in that section, then we go back to load up for the second load, right? That time there, everything come out, right? She was like, I can't believe them, so, you know, and it's like, all right, come. So we prayed again, Lord, top us up once again, if overshadow again, and then we went out and did the second section, right? Anyway, so when we finished that outreach, right, bank account dry, right, everything given out, and a couple of the, and we've been working with Majesty Gardens community as well. So the guys in Majesty were saying, boy, we really want to do something for the elderly. And I was like, boy, we really want to stand with you. We see the need, you know? And so we're gonna pray. Prayed, and the bank account stayed dry. Then on a Tuesday night, I went to a Bible study. And one of the guys there, he works in a security company, and they were putting up, anybody knows down on Twickenham, what name there, Lane, or anyway, there's near Majesty Gardens, there's a Grace canning factory. And because people keep jumping the fence and thiefing out the factory, they were putting up this security fence, okay, just to try and keep the place more secure. So he turns up at this Bible study and he says, guys, please, I have a prayer request. And this is, you know, we finished the Bible study, time to pray, what are we gonna pray about? He says, I have a prayer request. My men were down in at the place just opposite Majesty Gardens today, or actually he called it Baktu, just opposite Baktu today. And he said, a gang of boys from 10 years old down to 6 started flinging stones at them. So they're up on the factory roof trying to sort out everything and stones start fling. And so they looked at these boys and they said, hey guys, settle it down. And the boys threatened them. And then they try to talk to him again. And then one of these boys say, take up his cutlass and say, may I cut off your head with a cutlass? 10-year-old child. Right? So they came down off the roof because they could not work. So that they sent the security, and there's an armed security guard down there, you know. Two security guards go up on the roof, look across, and said to these boys, boys, settle down yourself. And then fling stone off of the security and make the security them run. Right? The security had to come off the roof. Now this to me is the saddest part of the whole story. They went to the police and they said, look, we have this real bad situation. What can we do? And policemen sit down and laugh after them and say, you have a gun and you can't pull it. These are 10-year-old, 7-year-old, 6-year-old boys. And you're supposed to pull your gun? Okay? So he's saying, look, I don't know what to do. Can you just pray into this situation? And we're like, yeah, let's pray. You know, really, let's pray into this. And so we prayed together in the Bible study that night. And I said, look, I know the community. I know a lot of people down there. So let me go see if we can, you know, intervene in a way. And it was like, oh my God, I got up in the morning. I was like praying, you know, Lord, we really want to do this outreach for Majesty Gardens. If I'm going down there today, I would love to set a date. But the bank account dry. So I guess we just trust you and pray and, you know, we'll do what we can. So finished prayer time, check the account. And because, you know, we have some Australian accounts, as you know, anyway, two major donations came in overnight. Okay. From the Bible study till the next morning. Yeah, you can praise the Lord. Okay. So we went down, so I called the guy, I said, guys, I want to come down and talk to you about the outreach and I want to set a date. So we went down there and then I said, oh, by the way, we also have a situation where some boys from the community have been flinging stones and stopping people from doing their work. And the guy who actually runs the security company had helped sponsor the food packages. So I'm like, you can't mash up relationships like that, you know? Okay. And so when I was talking to the guys, a couple of the other guys from the street corner, they came over. And they're like, them do what? And I said, it's all right, you know, we're just going to find the boys, we're going to find their parents, we're going to talk to them. Yeah, me, I'll talk to them. and you know what's coming, right? And so you're trying to calm it down and settle it down. And then one of them see one of him, you know everybody, right? When you're Majesty. So then he says, see one of them right there, so, and him call him over. And I'm saying, yesterday, people fling stone over there. Who was there? And this kid is like, you know, the deer in the headlights. He's like, why, eyes wide open. He's like, okay. So he said, and it's so funny, because the guy who is wanting to administer the vengeance of the Lord, you know, he's clearly, let's just say, he understands the legal system very well. Kind of said to the little kid, he said, I'm going to give you a plea bargain for reduce your sentence. Tell me every name of every kid who was over there, I'm going to go easy upon you. But if you will not tell me, worries for you. Right? Well, the kid was smart and took the plea bargain. And so he became our informer and we walked around Majesty Garden and we round up every little kid. Right? So then, there we are, and we round them all up, and by this time we're in this kind of shack area where there's a kind of a zinc roof above it, and there's where they play dominoes, and there's a little shop nearby and stuff like that, and we're there, and the parent, you know, because some people, it's like the Pied Piper, you're walking around and people start joining the crowd, and a wagwan, you know, and then worse, them see a white man walking up and down in there, you know, then, you know, something going on, right? Anyway, so there we are. And we're talking and we're saying, boy, these kids, them fling the stone off of the security guard and then fling the stone off of the workers, them and what and whatnot. And you can see just the temperature is starting to rise like this, going up. And you know, every now and then you're just like, oh God, please give me a word, right? Now, I've been doing some study, and in the study, literally the previous week, they had done a biblical study on justice and vengeance. And it was just the right word for the situation, okay? And so I'll just tell you how I summarized it for them. I was like, guys, please may I say something. Please may I speak to you guys right now. I want to say something to you. And they kind of look around and sort of, you know, then gradually agree with them. And I said, yeah, all right, make them on talk. So everybody settled down. And I was like, okay, guys, here's the thing, okay? And there was a post next to me that holding up the roof, and I put my hand up to the top of the post. I said, guys, this is justice. Okay, this is when everything is right. This is when you work for a man and them tell you, say, I'm going to pay you Friday, and then pay you Friday, right? You know that feel? And them say, eh, right? So I say, okay. Now, when things are not right, it's unjust. Boom, put my hand down the post. That's when things go wrong. That's when the man tell you for come Friday, and then them say you can't get no pay. But you done the work. And then look, they're with me, because they know what I'm feeling. And so I'm like, okay, what do you feel like when justice has gone missing? Feel like for do them something. Yeah, you feel like for do them something, don't it? What that name is vengeance. Boom. It always takes you further away from justice. So justice is when you set things back right again. Okay? And the consistent message of Scripture is that justice is something God asks of his people. Put things right. Vengeance is something God asks you to leave in his hands. The consistent message. If you get out your big concordance, or Google it if you're, you know, one of these young people who never had to do homework when there was no internet. But if you get out your big concordance and look up the word justice and look to every biblical reference in there, you will not find one where justice and vengeance is the same thing. We always think justice is where them get where them deserve. Okay? Justice is when things are set back right again. Okay? And vengeance is the thing you leave in the hands of God, because he's the one who actually knows the real situation. He knows the end from the beginning. So there I am. I said, guys, I don't want you to take vengeance on these kids. I want to set this thing back right again. Okay? How can we fix this back? How can we make it back right again? And they said, boy, well, we have to make sure them don't do it again. I was like, yeah, well, let's make sure they don't. So we talk to them, talk to the parents, talk to the boys, make sure they understand that if a man come to work and he's just doing his job and stone fling off him to the point that he can't work, that's not fair. That's not just. Don't do that. Don't do that again. Okay? And they, you can see they're just, oh, yeah, that makes sense. And so anyway, at the end of that little kind of thing, when I'm there saying that, I just said to him, guys, does that make any sense? And this guy across the other side said, yes, man, a lot of sense. You know, that's about how you bring the culture of the kingdom into the culture of the world. And it's good news. Okay. So anyway, we got to share that with them. You're very encouraging, Paulette. I appreciate it. Thank you. So we got to share that with them. And then we said, okay, you know what would be the best thing? Which one is the tool ringleader? Because, you know, when there's a six-year-old, you know, say, somebody drag him astray, right? Which one are the ringleader? Which one give the strength to the little ones to go do that? Aim. So, okay, I'm two. All right, the two of them. Okay. So you know what? Guys, you are some strong young men. We have some food package to pack out, rice to pack out, flour to pack out, cans to put in the thing. How about you come and help pack out the things then for the old people? And the mummies say, yeah, take them. Right? So then we got the opportunity to have these guys with us for the day. Right? And a couple of the guys from the community as well came to help out. Right? And a couple of times those boys, because them, you know, don't get a lot of discipline in their life, couple words come out them mouth that not to come out their mouth. And the man then turns and say, hey, you know, for you, them word, you know. Now, you can actually teach non-believers to be disciples. Okay? When you put them in a kingdom culture, in a kingdom opportunity. Now, as we were leaving the community, I called the security guy and I said, guy, I said, sorry. I said to him, it should be all right. We're safe now. Shouldn't be any more incident. Then a half hour later, the owner for Grace Canning called me and said, oh, him, give me your number. I just wanted to say thank you for coming down and intervening and being there. Can we assist? So I said, boy, you know what? We have this food package giveaway and we could really do with some tin products. So he said, all right, come by Friday and pick up 300 tins of baked beans. So in the end, you had stone throwers, factory stoners, factory owners, you know, people on the street, people from the church, people from the corner, young kids, everybody working together, people from overseas, people in Jamaica, all working together in order to bless the people who really needed it. Okay? That is how the kingdom responds. The alternative to the kingdom is, you have a gun, why you don't use it? Okay? So the kingdom does things differently, and that's our job, is to bring the kingdom into the world. So anyway, that's the setup. We're gonna get into our Bible soon, but I actually wanna show you the video now from that day, so I think you guys should have that queued up. I'm gonna tell you one last detail actually. On that same morning, I went to market really early to go buy all the stuff, came back, and then I have a little Bible study. Three of us meet together every second Friday morning and just do like a Bible study, you know, share from the word, pray for each other, confess our sins to one another, just a way of really keeping ourselves accountable and in fellowship with one another. If you don't have that in your life, I really recommend it to you. When the Bible says, when two or three are gathered in my name, I think it literally means two or three. We love to interpret it to mean 2, 3, 500 or whatever else, right? But honestly, the power of fellowship in two and three is something different. Okay? You can really go much deeper. You can confess your faults. You can pray for one another. You can, you know, engage in a different level in a two or three. So I had that morning. And I kind of said, okay, we're about to go into this thing and we're going to go to Majesty. And one of the guys said, boy, you know, you should play that worship song, Majesty. And I'm thinking that, you know, Majesty, worship is Majesty, which is, you know, nice, but kind of not my generation. Okay. So I was, you know, politely saying, yeah, sure. Anyway, we have a little WhatsApp chat for the thing, and he dropped in this other Majesty song, right? Which is slightly more, you know, closer to, I mean, it's a really worshipful song. Anyway, and I was like, oh, that's a really, yeah, we should. So we played it when we were packing out the packages. And then when I did the video for everything, I was like, I wonder if that track would work. Because, you know, it's Majesty, and we're going to Majesty, and we want to sing over it, something different. And so when I finished editing the video, I dropped the track into it. It was exactly the length of the video. I did not edit it one bit. And also you will see where there's a part when it really gets to the chorus. It is so powerful the way, it's just like, once again, the Holy Spirit superintendent. If you think it's my clever editing, no, right? It's sometimes God just arranges the pieces beyond what you can do, okay? So I'm gonna show you the video and then we're gonna look at a few more things.
This is good morning. This is John, Trey, Jerome, Kevin, and Mr. Knight. We are here from Majesty Gardens, joining Infusion. Packing out some care packages for some old persons and some persons who need assistance in other cigars. Mm-hmm. So this is a part of the process.
God bless you and keep you guys.
Amen.
Yes, and we do appreciate everything that you are doing for us and the other inner city community. God bless you.
God bless you and keep you. Thanks for everything.
Without you, God bless and keep you. See you.
Thank you.
Hi.
It's all good.
God is good, eh? Yeah, just the way he tied all of that together was just such an amazing thing. So look, we're going to get into Daniel, change gears a little bit, and get looking at this passage. It's an amazing book. I know you've been looking at it already. So the first six chapters are kind of telling the story, and then from 7 to 12, it's a record of these prophetic visions. And if you read it right through, you'll even notice it's a little bit confusing, because the first five chapters are kind of when Babylon is in charge, because the Babylonian Empire takes over and takes, you know, Daniel away into captivity. So they're in charge, and then the Mede and Persian Empire takes over, Cyrus. Now, then you go to chapter 7, and you go back to the Babylonians' time, because it's a record of the visions, and then from 9 to 12, you're back to Persia again. So it's this kind of jump back and forth in terms of what's happening. But essentially what's happening is you have these big global empires who are fighting for control. And little Israel is caught in the middle of it. And in fact, in the whole book of Daniel, they're caught in it way away from their homeland. They're actually traveling by road. And the thing is, when you're a slave, you know how you travel? You walk. Yeah, that's right. Daniel's well over 800 miles away, close to 900 miles away from his home. Okay? Now, Nigril is about 150 miles away, okay, when you are by road. So imagine walking that, and back, and back, and back, until you reach up to 900. That's a good little distance, yeah, for go. Right, so he's a long way away from home. And that's kind of the context and setting for this book. Now, I'm going to give you a little bit more background. And for this stuff, so if you can actually put up the slide, the first one there. So you see this is a screenshot. I went to a seminar. This is the lady on the corner there, is Dr. Cindy Parker. And I just left it as a screenshot because I don't want to teeth her slide and say it's me. Okay? So if what I tell you now is informative, just know that the source is not me, okay? But this is a satellite map of that whole area. And the two blue strips that she's kind of, you know, highlighted, essentially those are two big plain areas with a river running down the center of them. The lower one, the river runs north, it's the Nile. And so it runs from kind of south up to north into the Nile Delta. The other one is the Tigris and Euphrates. They both kind of run slightly in parallel to one another, as much as rivers ever do anything in parallel. Messy parallel. So that's the Tigris and Euphrates, and that's what you call Mesopotamia, that whole sort of section over there. And that you see how it kind of forms this sort of C shape. That's what they call the Fertile Crescent. Okay? The reason this whole area is so fertile is because those rivers, this huge plain area, and those rivers flood every year, and this rich, rich, rich soil gets taken out and spread out all over the land, and it becomes incredibly good farming, agricultural land. And so the earliest civilizations you see emerging are around these, there's historians kind of have discussions whether it was Egypt or whether it was Mesopotamia, but this is where the earliest civilizations emerge. Okay, because when you can plant and grow, you can get excess. When you can have a fertile area, you get excess. When you get excess, you can trade. When you trade, you can start to build up your system a little bit better. You can start taxes. And then when you start taxing, you can build an army, and then you can go out and conquer more countries. Okay? And so that's kind of, you see all of these empires emerge from around that belt. Now you notice that the crescent has a kind of cut in the middle. Right? And just have a look at the satellite thing. That little, so that you have the desert there, right? And then you have the Mediterranean Sea, and you have this tiny little thin strip of land stuck between the two. Okay? 1/5 the size of Cuba. Okay? All right? You have this little strip of land, inhabitable land, in the middle there. What do you notice about it looking at the satellite image? Right? You see that you have the nice flat, you know, deserty looking area, and the nice plains around the rivers. This one, rocky, right? Very, very contoured land. It's a very, very hilly country. Okay? So it's different. In Deuteronomy, when God is saying, you know, he's calling his people out of slavery, out of Egypt, he says, where you're going, the land you're going into is not like the land you're coming from. And it actually says, where you watered your crops with your heel. No, they actually did that. They ran the river around these irrigation systems with mud banks, and you just put your heel, broke the mud bank, and the water just run and water your crops. And when you have enough water on that field, you build up back the mud bank, and then you go and do the next one. That's how you water your crops. Easy thing, that. Okay? So when you have that system, you can get large. And when you get large, you can get in charge. Okay? When he said in Deuteronomy, if you read that, he says that it's not like that land. The land you're going into, it relies on water from heaven. Okay? Geographically, God instituted trust into where he wanted his people to live. Isn't that amazing? You can't just set it and have everything your way. You have to trust me. You have to rely on the water to come from heaven. Okay? There is a river down in the Jordan, but it's very, very, very deep. It floods a little, but it does not flood anything like the others. Okay? So when in Genesis 12, God says to Abraham, get up, leave your country. He was up in Mesopotamia. Okay? He was a civilized guy. And go to that little backwater, that out of the way place, and I'll make you a great nation. Sorry, God, define great. Because, you know, we think great is like big house, big car, right? I think God has a different definition of great than what we often think. So he's like, go there. And Abraham is forced through famine to leave. We'll soon get to that slide. Forced by famine to leave. And God says, no, you're going back. Then he said, then Jacob has to run away. No, you're going back. Then famine again. Joseph goes down to Egypt. Then his family gets to join him. And they get enslaved. He says, no, you're going back. Okay. God wanted his people to live there. Now, this next slide shows you the one significant benefit that that piece of land has. Those are trade routes. Okay? So all of the people of the earth, if they want, you know, when big people get big, they want to deal with one another, right? They want to trade with one another. So the big players want to trade with one another, and where do they have to go through? That little strip of land. On average, an army has marched through Israel every 43 years for the last 4,000 years. Very, very, very important piece of land, right? Because that's where all the trade routes come through, okay? So that's the one significant benefit of that piece of land, okay? It's not gonna be, you're not gonna, and this was the thing that, actually the line that Dr. Cindy Parker said that really struck me. She said, God called his people to live in a land where they could dominate no one and bless everyone. Whoa, what does that tell you about the character of the kingdom? Right there. Now, if you flip to the next slide, okay, this one is a kind of, yeah, there you go, it's kind of squashed up a little bit, but, so this is a just taken out of my study Bible, but you can kind of see around the edges, there's yellow lines, and there is some red lines. The red lines are the local roads. The yellow ones are the international roads. And the main international road, maybe because it's not that clear, I'll walk over here. I don't know if I'm messing up the thing, but this one right up here, so, going around Galilee, that's the most significant international artery running through Israel. There's another one that runs up the other side as well. Where did Jesus move when he started his ministry? He was in Nazareth, which is up on the hill in the country, and he moved to Capernaum. All of those dots all over there are Jesus's miracles. Most of them are around that Galilean area. Okay? If you flick to the next slide, when you see Jesus turn up, it talks about land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, Galilee of the Gentiles. Okay? So Zebulun is on your map there, and Naphtali is next to it. Anyway, if you want to get the slides from me later to look into it, or you just look in at the back of your Bible at the map. They kept being overrun by the Gentiles because at them of the road. The Gentiles are interested in that. They're not interested in Jerusalem, you know. It's only when Jerusalem become really troublesome. But they're very interested in that land. Okay? that is where the light has dawned. You know, upon you a light has dawned, right? Jesus came into that area. Why do you think people responded so well in that area to the news that the Messiah has come? And so badly in Jerusalem. Very simple, status quo. Status quo was working for the elites in Jerusalem, but it was not working for the people in that land. Right? Them are the yadi of that season, that time. Status quo not working for them. So they're not interested in it. They're not invested in it. So they're very interested in the good news of the kingdom. Anyway, so that's just some really helpful background stuff. All right? Now, we'll just run through these very, very quickly. So Daniel talks about these four kingdoms. And this, obviously, history is not neat, okay? It's like a melting pot, bubbling, and, you know, one kingdom step up and step down, and when them try overreach, you know, all the kingdoms that got conquered, they never really liked to be conquered, so they would try and, you know, exert power and come back again, and them decide why they can manage this fight, they go and take the fight. If they can't manage the fight, they're going back down from the fight and agree to terms. So that's, but if you look at the boundaries of those four kingdoms at their height, let's go for the first one. Okay, this was Babylonia at its height. Look which real estate they grabbed. The entire Fertile Crescent. Okay? Then the media is up in the corner, so they decided, you know what? We're going to get big and bad and take it over. So then you have the next slide. The Medes and Persians took the whole of that. And you can see they then started pushing over into Greece. At which point this guy said, Alexander said, not sure about that. And so then you get this, that's Alexander's empire, the Greek empire, okay, or a Hellenist empire. And then after that, you're going to get the last one. Now, this is a little time after Jesus when Rome was at its height. And then they took over that whole area, right? Now, all four of those, the piece they really want more than anything else is that Fertile Crescent. That's where they're going to, that's their breadbasket. Okay, now there's a lot of other wealth in a lot of other countries. But you see, that's why there was so much going on in this. So, all of that is background now to Daniel. We looked at Daniel 7, which was a vision. Daniel 2, which was the vision of the statues. Daniel 7 kind of reinforces the same thing. And this is very much symbolic prophetic language. A lot of times people read it and kind of try and map it out to this, that, the other, whatever. Okay, what I want you to do, you can even close your eyes as I read it. Just all I want you to do is just give me, it's meant to be symbolic. Okay, Jamaicans are actually very good at symbolic language. I was once in London and I was in a big, what's it called, a Ford Transit van with some of the guys who were doing street pastors, and we were going out to do the street pastoring. And we were heading out, there was a couple of Jamaicans and a couple of English people in the van, and we were heading out through this narrow little back street in London, and this taxi was coming the other way fast, and we were in this Ford Transit van, and you could see that if the driver stayed on his present course, would I lick up in or something? And so the Jamaican beside him just said, smile up yourself! And him smile up himself. And we're gone through no problem. No, do you think he literally meant suck in the vehicle? No. A lot of times people read Bible and they're like literally, it's just telling you for smile up yourself. You know, I hear that. Right? A lot of symbolism is just telling you. It's the spirit that's captured in the message. That's what you need to hear. Okay? Sometimes people go on off all kind of madness. And honestly, I'm going to take a little lick out here. And if you get upset by this, you can come talk to me about it later. Rapture, nonsense. Serious thing, okay? It in the dead, okay? There is a trumpet call many times in history to assemble the people when something significant happened. Yes, we are all going to be assembled when Jesus returns. Okay, I believe that, but I don't believe in a literal spiritual elevator. I don't think that's the message of Scripture. So anyway, if you're offended by that, come talk to me afterwards or read your Bible. But it's there is so much heat about post-trib, pre-trib, this, that, and it's just like, it's a nonsensical discussion. Okay, but I hear it a lot. Okay? Anyway, what the Bible is really telling you is just to small up yourself. Okay? It's telling you, hey, him I go come, and when him come, we are going to see him. And him I go gather we together. And it's a new time going come. That's the spirit of what's being said. Okay? So anyway, I know I've gone really controversial there, but you know, when you give the man the microphone and you didn't have face mask, then him can't say anything, you know, because you can't chat back. All right. Just Daniel 7. Okay, so again, just listen to the heart of this passage. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream. And visions passed through his mind as he was lying in bed. He wrote down the substance of his dream. Daniel said, in my vision at night, I looked, and there before me were four winds of heaven churning up the great sea. Four great beasts, each different from the other, came up out of the sea. The first was like a lion, and it had the wings of an eagle. I watched until its wings were torn off, and it was lifted from the ground, so it stood on 2 feet like a human being, and the mind of a human was given to it. And there before me was a second beast, which looked like a bear. It was raised up on its sides, and it had 3 ribs in its mouth between its teeth. It was told, get up and eat your fill of flesh. And after that I looked, and there before me was another beast, one that looked like a leopard. And on its back it had 4 wings like those of a bird. This beast had 4 heads, and it was given authority to rule. After that, in my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was a 4th beast, terrifying and frightening and very powerful. It had large iron teeth, and it crushed and devoured its victims and trampled underfoot whatever was left. It was different from the former beast, and it had 10 horns. While I was thinking about the horns, there before me was another horn, a little one, which came up among them, and 3 of the 1st horns uprooted before it. The horn had eyes like the eyes of a human being and a mouth that spoke boastfully. And as I looked, thrones were set in place, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was as white as snow, and the hair of his head was white like wool. His throne was flaming with fire, and its wheels were all ablaze. A river of fire was flowing, coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated and the books were opened. Then I continued to watch because of the boastful words the horn was speaking. I kept looking until the beast was slain and its body destroyed and thrown into the blazing fire. The other beasts had been stripped of their authority but were allowed to live for a period of time. In my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was one like a son of man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. Now, I don't know what the spirit that comes across through that to you is, but to me, it's chaos. It's like this crazy situation going on. There's all this fear, and it's meant to be frightening. And then finally, you just get relief. You get, oh, wow, something else comes, something of a totally different nature. Okay, the Son of Man, that's a very human term. Now, it's divine because it's like his authority and eternal kingdom, but it's also very human. You know what? The kingdoms of this world are inherently dehumanizing. They do not care about people. They're beastly in a very literal sense. The kingdom cares about people, the kingdom of God. I'll use, in fact, not to make it, not confusing, I'll use the term empire for, you know, the bad one, and kingdom for the good one, okay? So the empires of this world are inherently, the response of empire when kids are flinging stones, because school stopped for them, Zoom class not happening, mommy's struggling and she's in her problems, and them just did it idle. The response of the empire is draw your gun. The response of the kingdom is different. It values people. Okay? There is a lot of empire history in Jamaica. Thankfully, there is a lot of kingdom history here as well. Okay? The empire, it's interesting, even looking at the climate change conference recently and this whole thing of climate justice, because these countries have been emitting for how long and causing these problems for countries that have not been emitting much at all. And so they're bearing the brunt of other people's sins. And it's a really big issue. And they're saying, look, are you gonna acknowledge responsibility for this and put money on the table? In 2007, the 200-year anniversary of the abolition of slavery, they said, hey, let's apologize and maybe put some money on the table. And Britain, Portugal, Spain, and the Netherlands said, mm-mm. No, let's soften the language, just like they did with COP 22, 26, whatever it was called. Let's soften the language and let's call it an expression of regret. Why? Because empire and a business about people. Business about itself. Right? The kingdom cares about people. It's a totally different nature. So that's one of our questions. What's the character of the kingdom? What's the nature of this kingdom? Now, I'm going to look very quickly at a passage, then look at Daniel. So Exodus 34, 5 to 7. Now, this is a really important passage. This is, you could call this the John 3:16 of the Old Testament. It's the most quoted and referenced passage in the Old Testament by the Old Testament. You understand? Like, it's the most hyperlinked verse, right? It's quoted in the Psalms. It's quoted in Jonah. It's quoted in Deuteronomy. It's quoted many, many, many places. And it's come out of a prayer. Moses said, God, show me your glory. Show me your ways. You know, go with us. If you're not going with us, we don't go anywhere. Show me who you are. And God says, then the Lord came down in the cloud and stood there with him and proclaimed his name, the Lord. And he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord, the compassionate. Just pause there for a second, okay? God has always been compassionate. Right in Genesis, when them sin and put on fig leaf, God turned up to these people that were perfect and sinless, just turned sinner. And his response was, boy, may I kick you out, you know, but you can't go out looking like that. May I put on some real clothes? Okay, God has always been compassionate. So he clothed them. But this is the first time in Scripture when God explicitly lists his characteristics. That's why it's so often quoted. And the first thing God says about himself, compassion. There's another five attributes about that are related to his goodness. So compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Sounds good, right? Yet, he does not leave the guilty unpunished. And then you get this verse that's kind of hard to understand. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation. Now that just sounds, I mean, that's the last thing we're left with, and it's kind of like it leaves a bad taste in our mouth. Now, there's seven attributes in total. Six of them are great, and the last one sounds a little harsh. Okay? Now, just to say, this is not God just taking vengeance on people's children for what they did wrong. Okay? What this is, there's a symmetry. Six amazingly good attributes and one harsh one, and all of them are God. Okay? And the last one is just. God is a just God. He's a fair God. And he will not forsake his justice for anybody. Okay? Secondly, you know, parents and children, parents' behavior does affect their children, you know. It's a plain fact. Okay? We all live with the sins of our parents, and we all pass them on to our children. We had a child psychologist come and stay with us doing some training once. And it's kind of intimidating having a child psychologist in your home watching you parent your children. you know, every now and then you just hope she's in her room, not in the next room where she can hear. Right? She said, it was one time when I was feeling a little intimidated by it, and she said this quote, I never forget, it was so good. She said, as a parent, it's not what you do, it's what you do after what you did. Oh, praise God. Okay? You're going to get it wrong, but you can set it right. Okay? If you get it wrong and try to behave like you never do nothing wrong, that causes. I went to a seminar once downtown, and it was a youth seminar, a bunch of young people there, and the presenter said something about honesty, and then kind of got a little bit preachy and said, young people, you know, for tell lie. 15-year-old raised his hand and he stood up and he said, I'm 15 years old. My entire life, my mother told me my father was dead. 2 months ago, I discovered he's alive all this time. You adults, enough a lie. Woy! Okay? The parents' behavior affects the children. Seriously affects them. So this is just an expression of reality and justice, okay? But what's amazing about this verse is that the faithfulness thing is to thousands. The justice, God limits that, 3 and 4 generations. I'm going to put a limit to that. I'm not going to let that run forever, okay? But essentially, the heart of this passage is that, look, God is compassionate, but God is also just. God is firstly compassionate, but God is always just. God is always fair, okay? I'm going to skip the next verse just because of time. This one actually, there was in one of these chats. So we'll go to the next slide, which some of you guys might recognize because it was one of our chats. There you go. I saw this one, Kirk, and it inspired me. Okay. It's like this sort of, you know, because it got me thinking about the character of God, because at the top you have this sort of this slow, you know, by care personally, really caring about somebody, going down to not caring about them at all, and it's an interesting word they use there. And then the challenge directly, and silence, not saying anything, okay? And there's a little grid there. And I thought, gosh, and I won't go, you can go deep into that if you want to. If you want to ask Kirk Harris to send you articles, he can, okay? I flipped to the next one because it got me thinking about the nature of God. So I kind of recreated it. We got the next slide there. And I was just thinking about this thing, okay, God's compassion and justice and how it maps with it, okay? So you have compassion on one side and the other thing, you have no business about nobody, okay? The opposite of love is actually not hatred. The opposite of love is apathy. You don't care. Then you have this justice where you care about what's right and then you please yourself, you're living for yourself. Now, if you just want to please yourself and you're no business about nobody, that's vanity. That's the worst thing to be. And the world is full of it. Okay? But if you are very compassionate, but there's no justice, it's just license. It's just free to do anything. That doesn't help anybody. Likewise, if you're all about justice, but you don't care about people, that's just judgmental. Okay? God's glory, his character, is always, always, always perfectly compassionate and perfectly just. Okay? The character of the kingdom is the character of the king. And God is always perfectly compassionate and perfectly just. Now, we'll look at a few bits where Daniel reflects this. You've already looked at Daniel 2, where I just take verse 24. So this is where, you know, the king is saying, you guys can't tell me my dream, I'm going to kill you all. And Daniel, even though these guys are, you know, the wise men of Babylon, I mean, yes, he is under threat as well, but he takes the initiative. So verse 24, he goes in, then Daniel went to Arioch, whom the king had appointed to execute the wise men of Babylon. So you're a wise man of Babylon, and you're going to go and chat to the guy who's been appointed to execute you. Wise move. Okay? Don't execute the wise men of Babylon. Take me to the king and I will interpret the dream for him. That's somebody who has guts, who cares about justice, cares about things happening the right way, and also has compassion. It's like, hey, we can't just let everybody get killed because this king is had a bad dream. And you see that character kind of going on. Daniel 4 then again, so I'm just going to flip now to 4:19. Okay, so here we go. This is now Nebuchadnezzar's, Daniel has a dream, sorry, and interprets it. Verse 19 says, then Daniel, also called Belshazzar, was greatly perplexed for a time, and his thoughts terrified him. So the king said, Belshazzar, do not let the dream or its meaning alarm you. Belshazzar answered, my lord, if only the dream applied to your enemies and its meaning to your adversaries. Whoa, he's gonna tell him the truth, you know. But before he tells him the truth, he's compassionate to this king. This king who dragged him 800 miles from his homeland, who destroyed his temple, and as Doggy referenced, before you enter the king's service, you have a little operation. Okay, you become a eunuch. Now, if God is pronouncing judgment on the guy who made you a eunuch, you would kind of feel happy, probably, if you had a vengeful heart, vengeful mind. But Daniel does not. He has a compassionate heart first. But then he tells him the truth. He says, hey, you've been dissing the real king, and that doesn't work out well for anybody. So he tells him the truth, just. Verse 27 is amazing, actually. So just look at that one. It says, you have to read the whole story. We don't have time to go into all of it. But verse 27, therefore, your majesty. So after he's given him this warning, therefore, your majesty, be pleased to accept my advice. Renounce your sins by doing what is right and your wickedness by being kind to the oppressed. It may then be that your prosperity will continue. If you get back into right relationship with the eternal king, you have a chance. What if you don't? Sorry for you. And then you see King Nebuchadnezzar doesn't listen. He's still puffed up and proud. God humbles him, sends him out into the fields to eat grass like a beast. And then he acknowledges that there's a God in heaven and he's restored. Okay? The whole of Daniel 9 is an amazing prayer. I won't read the whole thing, but the whole of Daniel 9 is this repentant prayer for the nation. He's not saying, oh no, wicked, you know. He's like, God, we have sinned. We have done wrong. When I look at, you know, I just said about the COP26. When I look at the climate crisis, I'm like, God, we have done wrong. Have mercy. You know, have mercy on us. Right? It's a repentant prayer. That's the heart of somebody who knows the glory. Now, you could sum up so much of it in this little verse here, Daniel 11:32. You know, speakers always say they're drawing to a close, don't it? Daniel 11:32. Hold on, that's the wrong reference. No, it's the right reference. It says, with flattery, he will corrupt. So this is, sorry, the context here, this is talking about this godless ruler, basically, who's going to take over, this kind of antichrist figure. It says, with flattery, he will corrupt those who violated the covenant, but the people who know their God will firmly resist him. You know what? When Hitler rose up in Germany and was exterminating God's people, the Jewish people, Christians, church-going people, were on his side. They were placated by his flattery because them know church. No church and no God is two different things, you know. There were also some real kingdom-hearted believers who resisted him firmly. Okay? Should I even mention the fact that 78% of white evangelicals voted for Donald Trump to get a second term? 78%, we don't understand that. Seriously, I don't understand that. I'm not saying I like Biden. What I am saying is I cannot imagine Jesus sitting on the hillside of Galilee, talking to his disciples about whether Mark Antony or Octavian was the best man for the empire. We're kingdom people, okay? We pray for them. When Trump was in office, I was praying for him. Biden, I'm praying for him, you know? Andrew, I'm praying for him, okay? That's our ultimate allegiance, okay? I'm wrapping up now, but my fatality is, right? You're a human being, okay? You cannot not love. You're going to love something. Will it be the king? Okay? And if you want to do a little audit to know what it is that you love, I saw this little email tagline, great one. It says, you show what you mean by what you do. Oh my. What you repeatedly do, that reveals to you what you love. Okay? We live in a generation that is really, really, really trying to capture our loves. Okay? We have to keep the king as our first love. Yakum gave a message about that earlier this year. Man, you should listen to that one again. It was packed with power. Okay? We are primarily lovers. We have to direct that love. I remember a Canadian teacher once saying, lead your heart. Okay, we often think, oh, let our heart lead me. No, your heart's stubborn. Lead your heart, direct it, point it towards the king, and then you will reflect the kingdom in your behavior, in your actions, in the way you function. Okay, so as we wrap up this, we started, so that's a bit about Daniel. I'll just read this last little part here in Daniel 12. So this is where he points now to the end of the story. And he says, at that time, Michael, the great prince who protects your people, will arise. And there will be a time of distress, such as not happened from the beginning of nations until then. But at that time, your people, everyone whose name is found written in your book, will be delivered. Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. That's what's coming, okay? The good news is that the kingdom that is coming and the king who will reign forever has entered history. If you want to sum up the gospel in three words, it's this: Jesus is Lord. He's Lord of the entire universe, and therefore he's my rightful Lord. Okay? He has taken lordship. The beginning of the ministry, he's in the desert, and the devil said, hey, all authority has been given to me. And Jesus never said, you're wrong. When Jesus rose from the dead, guess what he said to his disciples? All authority has been given to me. Guess what? There's been a power change. Okay? The battle has been won. The king is in charge, and it's a present reality. And it means that blessings will flow to those who live by the character of the kingdom. In fact, more than that, they will flow through those. Not that you're going to start dominating people, but so you can be a blessing to people. Okay? The rain of heaven will fall on the land when the land is honoring the king. That's what we're called to. To finish it out, I'm just going to flip to Matthew 7. Actually, Matthew 5 and 6. Well, let me just go for Matthew 7 because of time. The Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus starts it, he talks about being salt, light, and he talks about what you do. Okay? At the end of it, I said to the guys on the thing that I was going to use the NIV, but I read it this morning in the Patois, and I have to come back to the Patois version for this one, okay? Matthew 7, from verse 24. Everybody will hear what me say, and do what me say, coming like one man who have sense, and build up a house upon a rock stone. The rain fall, the place flood out, and the breeze blow hard, and beat against the house. But the house needn't mash down, because a rock stone, it built upon. But all on the way, you hear me say, but not even a pain in the mind, coming like one foo-foo man, where build him house upon sand. The rain fall, and boy, I love this verse. The rain fall, the place flood out, the breeze blow, and it dropped down braps. And mash up. That's what the part of Bible say. It dropped down braps and mash up. My daughter gave me a t-shirt with a fantastic theological statement on it. God says it, just tweet, at the beginning of the sermon and the end. Oh, you guys can't see it over there. Thank you, Pastor Harry, for considering those on each side. Just tweet. Okay? That's how Jesus starts his message, how he finishes his message. Say, hey, I'm the king, I'm in charge. Okay. If you find the Bible hard to understand, don't worry ahead. Whatever you understand, just do it. Okay? That's when you will know that the king is in charge. Because he will meet you, he'll be present with you. He loves to be present with those who hear him. So we've covered a lot. We'll just put up those questions again. What is the kingdom? What is the character of the kingdom? And how can the people of the kingdom reflect that character? Hopefully, something that we've said, hopefully it's something that I've covered, something that I've said, will give you some insight into those, right? That is how you live a lifestyle that brings the good news into the world. The people who know their God, okay? Know the king, know his character, know that he is 100% compassionate and 100% just. And bring that message into the world. And it will transform beasts into humans. That is the good news, and it's a message that's present with us now. Thank you for giving me the time.
As he takes his bag and pan with him. Thank you, David. Thank you, David. Let's show appreciation. There's a lot that we can and need to take away from that message. And that which you're able to extract, that the Lord has spoken to you specifically, because not everything is going to jump at you and grab hold of you. But what the Spirit of the Lord has been speaking to you based on where you're at, just do it. Amen. And we're going to pray and ask God to help us to just do it. The grace that we need to respond to him. For those who may be listening and not of the Jamaican heritage, just go and do it. And whatsoever thou doest, do quickly. I want to ask Pastor Bruce, who's just going to come and just say a word before we close.
Morning, brethren. You know, I saw that Just Do It, and I remember I nearly got a spanking from my mother many years ago for spelling the word do it. But there it is, D-W-E-E-T. Yes, the British culture lingered. I just want to say thank you, David, for that word. I think you answered the questions, what is the kingdom, you know, and how we can characterize it. I have to say, a point of clarification, David gave a personal view on the rapture, which is, I don't know what the view is, because he didn't elucidate, but the point is, though, is that as a community, the word rapture does not appear in the New Testament at all. It originates from a Latin translation of a phrase that Paul used in 1 Thessalonians 4. And many stories have abounded about the rapture. As an early Christian growing up, you know, I heard about being left behind, and many things have been built around it. There were many disputes about whether this rapture is going to take place before the tribulation, after the tribulation, before God's wrath, before the millennium, after the millennium, all sorts of things. So without getting into the theological niceties, I must, however, emphasize that as a church, we do believe in the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. David didn't say he didn't, so you know, I know he does. But just to clarify, I would hesitate to say that it is nonsense. I disagree with much of what I've heard about it, but I would hesitate to say that I wouldn't call it nonsense, because the scripture does speak about the coming of the Lord in multiple places. The fact that people have different understandings, that will probably only be cleared up when Jesus returns. But I just thought it necessary, and I mentioned to David that I would have to, he's my friend, but I have to clarify. So whatever we call it, by whatever name we call it, we live in anticipation of the return of the Lord Jesus. Amen. And you know, David spoke about the world trying to capture our love, and one of the antidotes to resisting the love of the world is to live in anticipation of his return. We live in the lens of eternity. Amen. God bless you.
Amen. So as we get ready to go out into the world, we crave God's grace to help us to respond to the Holy Spirit's prompting, who should be the one guiding and influencing us. Amen.